Thank you. as old as the ages themselves, and has ever been the subject of investigation and experiment. But as to the right use of the human faculty and forces, the knowledge is in its infancy. Only in this age and generation is it at last possible to impart the laws of magnetic healing, and to indicate the causes of those diseases, originating in the three inner bodies, which today devastate the human frame, cause endless suffering and pain, and usher man through the portal which leads to the world of bodiless existence. Only today is man at the point in the evolution of his consciousness where he can begin to realize the power of the subjective world, and the new and vast science of psychology is his response to this growing interest. Processes of adjustment, of elimination and of cure engage the minds of all thoughtful people as well as of all suffering people. We have much to do, and I ask therefore for patience on your part. When one enters the realm of healing, one enters a world of much esoteric knowledge, and of an infinity of conclusions, and one is faced with the formulations of many minds, who, through the ages, have sought to heal and to help. The why and the wherefore of disease have been the subject of endless investigations and speculations, and much definite deduction has been made as to the cures of such complaints. There has been also much formulation of methods, of techniques, of formulae, of prescription, of varied manipulations and of theories. All these serve to fill the mind with many ideas, some correct, some erroneous, and this makes it most difficult for new ideas to enter and for the student to assimilate the hitherto unknown. Aspirants lose much by refusing to let go of that which the lower mind cherishes. When they do succeed in being entirely open-minded and are ready to accept the new theories and hypotheses, they discover that the old and dearly held truth is not really lost, but only relegated to its rightful place in a larger scheme. All initiates of the ageless wisdom are necessarily healers, though all may not heal the physical body. The reason for this is that all souls that have achieved any measure of true liberation are transmitters of spiritual energy. This automatically affects some aspect of the mechanism which is used by the souls they contact. When I employ the word mechanism, in these instructions I refer to different aspects of the instrument, the body or form nature, through which all souls seek manifestation. I refer, therefore, to 1. The dense physical body, which is the sum total of all the organisms which compose it, these. Copyright 1998 Lucis Trust. 2. The Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Possess the varying functions which enable the soul to express itself on the physical or objective plane as part of a greater and more inclusive organism. The physical body is the response apparatus of the indwelling spiritual man and serves to put that spiritual entity on repair with the response apparatus of the planetary logo, the life in which we live and move and have our being. 2. The etheric body, which has one main objective. This is to vitalize and energize the physical body and thus integrate it into the energy body of the Earth and of the solar system. It is a web of energy streams, of lines of force and of light. It constitutes part of the vast network of energies which underlies all forms whether great or small, microcosmic or macrocosmic. Along these lines of energy the cosmic forces flow, as the blood flows through the veins and arteries. This constant, individual, human, planetary and solar, circulation of life courses through the etheric bodies of all forms is the basis of all manifested life, and the expression of the essential non-separateness of all life. 3. The astral or desire body sometimes called an emotional body is the effect of the interplay of desire and extension's response upon the self at the center, and the resultant effect in that body is experienced as emotion and as pain and pleasure and the other pairs of opposites. In these two bodies, the etheric and astral bodies, 90% of the causes of physical disease and troubles is to be found. 4. The mental body, or with much of the chitta or mind stuff which an individual human unit can use and impress, constitutes the fourth of the series of mechanisms at the disposal of the soul. At the same time, let it not be forgotten that these four constitute one mechanism. 5% of all modern disease originates in this body or state of consciousness, and here I wish to enunciate the truth. A million years hence, when the focus of human attention has shifted from the emotional nature to the mind, and when men are essentially mentalist today, they are essentially emotional, then the causes of disease must be sought in the mind realm. They are today to be found, except in a few rare cases, in lack of vitality or in too much stimulation, and in the realm of feeling, of desires thwarted or overindulged, and in the moods, suppressions, or expressions of the deep-seated longing, irritation, secret delights and the many hidden impulses which emanate from the desire light of the subject. This urge to be into the past first of all built, and is building, the outer physical response apparatus, and is today forcing a mechanism that has been constructed essentially for physical ends, to serve more subjective purposes. This again produces trouble, and only when man realizes that within the outer physical sheath there exist other bodies which serve more subtle response purposes, will we see the gradual readjustment and health of the physical body. If these more subtle sheaths we shall later deal. Copyright 1998 Lucid Trust. 3. A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. You naturally ask here, what is the general plan which I shall seek to follow as I instruct you in the laws of healing, those laws which guide the initiates and must gradually supersede the more physical methods in the present art of healing. You naturally also seek to know what is the special technique which you, as healer, must learn to employ, both as regards yourself and as regards those you seek to heal. I will briefly outline the teaching I shall endeavor to give and point out where you must lay the emphasis as you commence the study of this subject. I shall endeavor first of all to touch upon the causes of disease, for the occult student must ever begin in the world of origins and not in the world of effects. In the second place, I shall elaborate the seven methods of healing which govern the work of restitution, as it is called in the occult terminology, as practiced by the initiates of the world. These determine the techniques which must be employed. You will note that these methods and techniques are conditioned by the rays, of which I have written elsewhere, *1, and that therefore the viewer has to take into consideration not only his own ray but also the ray of the patient. There are therefore seven ray techniques, and these require elucidation before they can be applied intelligently. In the third place, I shall lay emphasis upon psychological healing and upon the need to be story of the patient in his inner life, for the basic law underlying all occult healing may be stated to be as follows. Raw eyes. All disease is the result of inhibited soul life, and that is true of all forms in all kingdoms. The art of the healer consists in releasing the soul, so that its life can flow through the aggregate of organisms which constitute any particular form. It is interesting to note that the attempts of the scientist to release the energy of the atom is of the same general nature as the work of the esotericist when he endeavors to release the energy of the soul. In this release, the nature of the true art of healing is hidden. Herein lies an occult hint. In the fourth place, we will consider the physical body, its diseases and ills, but only after we have studied the part of man which lies behind and surrounding the dense physical body. In that way we shall work from the world of inner causes to the world of outer happenings. We shall see that all that concerns the health of man originates from 1. The subterranean forces, feelings, desires and occasional mental processes which characterizes the three subtler bodies and determines the life and experience of the physical body. 2. The effect upon the physical body of the condition of humanity as a whole. A human being is. Copyright 1998, Lucas Trust. 4. The Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. An integral part of humanity, an organism in a greater organism. Conditions existing in the whole will be reflected in the moon itself. And many of the ills from which man suffers today are the effect upon him of conditions existing in the fourth kingdom and nature as a whole. For these he is not held responsible. 3. The effect upon his physical body of the planetary life, which is the expression of the life of the planetary logos, who is an evolving entity. The implications of this are largely beyond our ken, but the effects are discernible. I am not interested primarily in training individuals in order to make them more efficient healers. It is group healing at which I aim, and it is the work which is done in formation which interests me at this time. But no group of people can work as a unit unless they love and serve each other. The healing energy of the spiritual hierarchy cannot flow through the group if there is disharmony and criticism. The first work, therefore, of any group of healers, is to establish themselves in love and to work towards good unity and understanding. I would like to point out here the need for patience as a healing group integrates in the auras of the group members blend. It takes a little time for people to learn to work together in perfect understanding and impersonality, and at the same time to achieve, during their work, a one-pointedness which will produce the needed group rhythm, a rhythm of such unity and intensity that the work can synchronize internally. Aspirants and students as they work along these lines must train themselves to think as a group, and to give to the group without a niggardly or reticent spirit the best that is in them, and also the fruit of their meditation upon these matters. I might also add that these instructions must be as concise as possible. I shall have to endeavor to put much taken information into a group space, so as to make each sentence convey some real idea and put some real light on the problems which confront a healing group. That which I have to say will fall into two parts. First, you will deal with the general work of healing and teaching, and this will involve the impartation by me of laws, of techniques and methods. Secondly, we will consider the healer and how he can protect himself in the art of healing. Is it not true that the time requisite of all healers is a sympathetic rapport, which is the confidence of the patient? Two words I give you which embody the requirements of all true healers, and towards which you must carry. Above everything else, and he must attract to him A. The power of his own soul. This involves alignment through individual meditation. B. Those whom he can help. This involves a decentralized attitude. Copyright 1998 Rufus Trust. 5. A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. C. Those energies, when need arises, which will stimulate the patient to the desired activity. This involves occult knowledge and a trained mind. The healer must understand also how to radiate, for the radiation of the soul will stimulate the activity. The soul is the one to be healed, and the healing process will be set in motion. The radiation of his mind will illumine the other mind and polarize the will of the patient. The radiation of his astral body, controlled and selfless, will impose a rhythm upon the agitation of the patient's astral body, and so enable the patient to take right action, whilst the radiation of the vital body, working through the splenic center, will aid in organizing the patient's coarse body and so facilitate the work of healing. Therefore, the healer has the duty of rendering himself effective, and according to what he is, so will be the effect upon the patient. When a healer works magnetically and radiates his soul force to the patient, that patient is enabled more easily to achieve the end desired, which may be complete healing, or it may be the establishing of a state of mind which will enable the patient to live with himself and with his complaint, unhandicapped by the karmic limitations of the body. Or it may be enabling the patient to achieve with joy and facility the right liberation from the body and, through the portal of death, to pass to complete health. Part 1. The basic causes of disease. This is the problem with which all medical practice down the ages has wrestled. In our present mechanistic age, we have wandered far to the surface of things and away from the partially true point of view of earlier centuries which traced the days back of the fever humors, bred and festering in the inner subjective life of the patient. In the evolution of knowledge on every hand, we are now on the surface of things. Note I do not use the word superficial, and the hour has struck in which knowledge can again re-enter the realm of the subjective and transmute itself into wisdom. Whereas today a dawning recognition on the part of the best minds in the medical and allied professions, that in the subjective and hidden attitudes of the mind and of the emotional nature, and in the light of exhibited or expressive sense expression, must be not the causes of all disease. From the beginning of our studies, I would like to point out that the ultimate cause of disease, even if known to me, may fail to be comprehended by you. The cause lies back in the history of the distant past of our planet, in which the earth is totally understood. interpretation of the basic cosmic truth, with your mind in any way certified. When I came back with the law of karma, nicely understood and rightly wielded, can bring that rich produce of happiness, bliss, and freedom from pain more easily than a brain pain, but its pain is the law of karma is not the law.
Thank you.
population of animals, we rightly cause the spread. In spite of all the indebtedness of mankind to the medical profession of trade, and the service rendered to humanity by the profession which was the loss of the needle. That they know not everything is true, that there is a small percentage of physicians and surgeons less than in any other profession, who don't have time and no credit to their
I'm Thank you.
location of the eye, second ray, heartfelt blood, heart trouble, cellulite, love wisdom, personality, stomach trouble, new blood, third ray, psychosexuality, social diseases, parental love, activity, overactivity, new life, fourth ray and selfishness, insanity, mysticism, harmony, dogmatism. interpreted testimony to this effect, and when men can read the records more correctly and with right interpretation, they will understand the layout, but that they will see more clearly the underlying causes. Cancer is a gift to modern man from the Atlantean humanity, and the scourge of this disease was the major factor which devastated the inhabitants of Old Atlantis. The roots of this dire evil are deep-seated in the emotional or desire nature, and are grounded in the astral body. Cancer is partially the result of a reaction to the diseases connected with the sex life which became so rampant in later Lemurian times and early Atlantean days. The people of those times, seeing the fearful evils and the extent of the disease which grew up out of the fertile Lemurian life, resulting from the promiscuous sex life on every hand, for the sake of self-preservation dammed back the natural flow of desire, the flow of life as it expresses itself through the centers of reproduction and procreation, and this in due time produced other evils. Cancer is primarily a disease of inhibition, just as the syphilitic diseases are those of overexpression and overuse of one aspect of the mechanism of man. Today, owing to the vast reaches of time involved and to the untold generations of those who have died upon the earth, so called by the unlearned thinker, a regret complaint of cancer are to be found in the very soil on which we live, infecting the vegetable kingdom and also the human family. A correspondence to the syphilitic complaints of man are to be found in the mineral kingdom. Tuberculosis, which was devastatingly rampant at a certain stage in Atlantean times, was nevertheless a disease which has been generated principally in our Aryan race, and one which we are bequeathing to the animal kingdom and are sharing with them. This is beginning to be realized. So close, however, is the relation between men and animals, particularly the domestic animals, that they today share with men practically all his ailments in some form or another, sometimes recognizable and sometimes not. Curiously enough, the cause of this great white scourge is to be found in the fact that the shift of the life emphasis away from the emotional nature into that of the mind nature, producing a temporary starvation of the emotional nature. It is largely a disease of depletion. Cancer, in its turn, was based similarly on a previous shift of the life force from the physical body into that of the emotional nature, producing an overdevelopment of the cellular life through overstimulation. I realize the difficulty of grasping these statements. I can only give you these unsubstantiated hints. Later discoveries alone conclude the truth of my suggestion. Let us here tabulate our conclusions. Copyright 1998 Rules of Trust. 37. The Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4. Esoteric Healing. Disease. Race. Body. Kingdom. Organ. Syphilitic. Lemurian. Physical. Mineral. Sex organs. Sacral center. Cancer. Atlantean. Astral. Vegetable. Solar plexus. Tuberculosis. Aryan. Mental. Animal. Breathing apparatus. Growth center. In referring above to the centers, I am referring to the center for the distribution of the life force, wherein the emphasis for the mass will be found. From the above it will be apparent where the emphasis of the possible clue will have to lie. Already, and because it is the latest, and therefore the least deep seated of the three major diseases inherited by modern man, we have learned how to cure tuberculosis. It has been discovered when the mind was intelligently applied to the problem that sunshine and good food would cure, or at any rate arrest, the disease. It is an interesting item in the field of esoteric correspondence that just as the light of the soul, pouring into the mind, can be depended upon to solve any problem, for that light of the sun and its prophylactic rays can dispel the dread symptoms of tuberculosis. Similarly, as the race develops right emotional control, we shall see the gradual disappearance of the phenomena of cancer. I said right emotional control, inhibition and the suppression of the desire impulses by the force of the will is not right control. It is interesting also to note that though both men and women suffer from the disease of cancer, the general cause is not identical, though the basic cause reaction from an overexpression of the sex life to the cultivation of the desire nature remains the same. Women, owing to the risks they run in childbearing, through the turning of the life emphasis to the sex aspect of life, have revolted on a large scale as did the Atlanteans against this form of life expression, and it is along this line, the sex line, that their major inhibitions are found. They do not suffer so much from the general inhibition of the emotional desire to an expression. Men who suffer from this latter inhibition and have a tradition or a marked tendency to greater emotional control in the handling of life than have women. Men do not require or acquire so marked a sex control. The general field of their inhibited life tendency is therefore of greater extent, and consequently the statistics can be trusted more men suffer from cancer than do women, though it is a dread disease, feared by all. In the secret of right transmutation lies the cure of cancer, and this will eventually be realized. I am using this phrase not only symbolically but also technically and scientifically. This again will later be seen. In the secret of right rhythmic living and in the right proportional accent upon all phases of life will come, and it is rapidly coming complete immunity from tuberculosis. In the secret of right understanding of times and cycles and of periodic reproductive creation, will come the emergence of the ways from the evils of the social diseases. It will be apparent to me, therefore, that the syphilitic diseases will be the last to disappear, just as they were the first to devastate the race. Tuberculosis is disappearing, the attention of the experts is now being given to the cure of cancer. Copyright 1998 Lucas Crush. 38. A treatise on the seven rays. Volume 4. Esoteric healing. I would like to add one or two comments here to be of general or rather modern interest. I have said that these taints to which humanity is prone are found in the soil, and that their presence there is largely due to the burial, down the ages, of millions of corpses. By the increased use of the processes of cremation, this condition will be steadily improved. Gradually, very gradually, the taint will thus die out. It is therefore highly desirable that there be as much propaganda as possible for the use of this method of disposing of the discarded physical vehicles of the souls who are passing out of incarnation. As the soul becomes less tainted, and its soul contact is established, we can hope to see a steady decrease in the number of those who succumb to the inherited taint. Curiously enough, the free use of salt sea bathing has a definite emptiness of the physical body. The water, incidentally absorbed through the medium of the skin and by the mouth, has a vitally prophylactic effect. One of the major problems today to the psychologist and in a lesser degree to the medical man is the growth of homosexuality, both female and male. Specious arguments are brought forth in order to prove that this abnormal development and the consequent interest in this morbid tendency is due to the fact that the race is slowly becoming androgynous in its development and that the future hermaphroditic man or woman is gradually making its appearance. This, again, is not true. Homosexuality is what you call a left over from the sexual aspect of Lemurian time, an inherited taint, if you like. Egos were individualized and incarnated in that vast period of time are the ones who today demonstrate homosexual tendencies. In those days, so urgent was the sexual appetite, the normal processes of human intercourse did not satisfy the insatiable desire of the advanced man of the period. Full force, strong intuitive processes of individualization served to stimulate the lowest centers. Hence, forbidden methods were practiced.